name's Ben Duval, and are you taking off with the, okay. Just jump right into it. The name of this talk is Modern Day Alchemy, Using Python to Analyze the Stock Market. Whole reason went ahead and called it Modern Day Alchemy is because if you get good enough at it, you pretty much have a currency printer in your own home. So I guess that'd probably be the goal, but we'll see if anyone can get there after this. And just a little bit of background on myself. My name is Ben Duval. I have an undergraduate degree in mechanical engineering, and then I decided to go to law school after that, and I am currently employed at Huntington Bank. Whole reason I got into programming, definitely dabbled in it during undergrad, and then just kind of kept up with it as a passion. And there's a lot of great resources out there. I mean, Codecademy, there's a lot of massively open online courses. There we go. And then we're gonna take a quick 10-minute break because I don't know about you, but I cannot sit still for 2 hours straight. I would have to check my phone or something. So we'll just take a little break there. Then wrap up with building a MySQL database. Another little deviation I had from the original plan, which was to use SQLite, but I just prefer MySQL to SQLite. So we'll stick with that. But I mean, SQL and database transactions, it's pretty similar across most databases unless you get into NoSQL, but we're not touching that. So we'll be using MySQL, and then we'll be looking at some Python code that will take all your open, high, low, closed data, actually put it into your database, and then use pandas to analyze your saved data, followed by any questions or answers. Question and answer seminar. Okay, and we'll just use this periodically so you can kind of have a roadmap as we progress through things and see where we are. So the website we're going to be looking at is called The Street, and it's Jim Cramer's website. I'm guessing some of you may be familiar with Jim Cramer, kind of the guy who really broke finance into more of like the rock and roll type of experience than it probably traditionally was. So here's a picture of Jim Cramer right there. So take a quick look at his site. All right, so thestreet.com, I mean, tons of information on here. If you're just looking at it and you're like, let me check out this homepage and see if I can gain any information from it. I mean, it's just got information all over the place. And really what we're trying to do here is realize that there's just so much information on financial data and that what we want to do is just be able to distill it into what it is that we actually care about and what it is that we want to use. So he does have one section of this website that's a little bit more straightforward. Let me hop over to that. I'm sorry, I can't really see what's on the screen, so I'll have to flip them back and forth. Okay, so what he does have here is this stock screener that you'll see here. So basically he just lists, what is it, I don't know, about 8 to 10 different stocks and what he feels is going to occur with them. So you'll see that some of them have a down arrow, some of them have an up arrow. So we'll just look through a couple days worth of this and we will go ahead and pick the stocks that it is we want to analyze and kind of see how they performed over the next day to see if we agree with Jim Cramer or if we disagree with what Jim Cramer has to say. All right, so flipping back to the presentation. Okay, someone kind of on the opposite spectrum of Jim Cramer, this is just for, Nassim Taleb, he's wrote a bunch of good books, he was a trader back in the day, kind of made his term for it is FU money, and what he means by that is if your boss calls you on the phone and tells you to do something you don't want to do, you just say FU and you hang up, because you've made enough, you don't need to be in the game anymore. So one of the things he always speaks about is having skin in the game, and what he means by that is, I mean, people like Jim Cramer, when you have a show that you don't necessarily have your own money invested, you can make whatever kind of picks you want because your money is based on the show you produce, not necessarily guaranteeing that you have to be right. So his big take on the financial markets and everything surrounding it is that if you have skin in the game and the people that are making the rules and the people that are at the helm of these companies, if they really have a lot to lose themselves personally, then we'd have a more cohesive financial system. So we're over to part two now, which is determine the location of the down for stock market prices. So just a quick blurb about the document object model. And it's the programming interface for HTML and XML documents. So if you've ever seen the document tree, or if you ever hopped into some HTML and you've seen the way that they have the tag system set up, that is your DOM. So I'm going to go ahead and look into that. This is a different DOM, if there's any Fast and Furious fans. When I Googled DOM, this was one of the first things that came up. So Toretto, number 8 coming out in another year here or so. But this is your basic structure for the DOM. You have your root element, so identified as an HTML document, and then get into your head where you have all your tags, then you get into your body where you actually get the data that you are interested in. So, and so we'll flip back to our website really quick to get an example of what it is we're looking for. So basically any website, you can just go and you go to inspect. And this brings up your DOM. If you see all these tags that are going down the side here, this is all what you're looking for. So there is a program actually out there, it's called Beautiful Soup, and what you can do with that is parse the DOM and figure out whatever you're looking for. The whole application of this is, let's say you didn't want to have to go to this website on a daily basis and write down all the tickers he has listed. Using Beautiful Soup, you could basically go into each one of these individually and let's see if I can change my view here, make this a little easier on myself. Okay, so that's not quite working. So while going through your DOM, we'll hop into some Python code really quick so you can see exactly what that looks like. Okay, so just hopping into some code really quick here. You have your import statements up here, and when you're dealing with Beautiful Soup, you just import that from BS4. If you go to their website, beautifulsoup.com, not sure on that. Just Google Beautiful Soup, you'll be able to find it. And it has some pretty good tutorials giving you exactly what you need. As far as actually, after you have it implemented with this statement over here, the next thing you'd want to do is, the way you really implement it is you tell it where you're getting your content from. So we're using the URL lib2 to tell it where it's getting its content from. And then within there, there's separate identifiers you use using regular expressions as well in order to point to the exact tag which you want to grab the information from. So. And this is an actual example that'll go through and pull everything that's from the website district we were just looking at for today. So if we run that, here are the actual elements you use. And the way that's doing the scraping is it's looking for your A, those are your link tags within HTML. And it's using some regular expressions to make sure you're picking up only letters and you're picking up anything that's between 5 and 2 letters, which basically gives you all the tickers that you're gonna need. So take a look just to make sure that we're getting exactly what we thought we should be. And over here, dates, for some reason I don't have yesterday's date on there. What this program is pulling is yesterday's picks. So some overlap, some not, but That's totally fine for our purposes. Any questions over the code that's used in order to do the web scraping? Anything in particular?
Do you have this on GitHub?
Not yet. I can either email it to you or put it up on GitHub. Yeah, I should probably just put it up on GitHub. That's probably the best way to go. Okay. All right, so then a little bit more information on Beautiful Soup, which is what we discussed before. And it really provides pretty simple methods for navigating the DOM tree in order to, or the DOM model, in order to grab any information that you need. As far as the coding goes, Unicode, UTF-8, whatever it is you need to use. You can also LXML, XML, HTML, 5. You can parse anything that's really in a DOM model. And so really the three steps you want to use when you're dealing with Beautiful Soup is you want to determine the location within the DOM that the data you're looking for resides, and then you find a unique way of distinguishing the data using either the system of tags that it resides in or some type of regular expression string matching. Both of those will work. And then you want to take that list that you have and or list array, however you want to store it, in a proper container in order to use it later in your program. All right, and then at this point in the agenda, we're going to find our data source for 1 year, or actually 1 day of your open, high, low, close. So as far as your data source, anything you're doing in finance, data is a pretty big piece of it. If you're doing any type of back testing or you want to do any type of algorithmic trading models. One thing about data is it is fairly expensive. It can run anywhere from a couple hundred bucks a month to a couple thousand dollars a month, I mean, especially if you're big. Institutional trader. Here's an example of some Bloomberg terminals that seems like a reasonable amount of data for one person to get through. So I'm sure he's loving his job. A couple cups of coffee, maybe. That's basically what Bloomberg terminals look like, and within their houses, basically all the data you could ever want to know. But again, the whole point of what we're trying to do here is help you to realize a way to get your data in a succinct manner so that you're not needing to spend hours and hours each day kind of trolling the web and trying to find the pieces that you need. So what we're going to be using today is Google actually puts some data out there for free, and it's a little bit hidden as far as getting their intraday pricing. You have to use this string, which it's not very much accessible on their finance page. If you go on there, you won't really be able to find any information about this. But basically how it works is google.com/finance. And then where it says equal, and there's the italicized and underlined ticker, that's literally just where you put in whatever stock symbol you are trying to analyze. So to tie back to the Beautiful Soup piece, what you do here is that container where you have all of the tickers that you scraped through. You would then loop through in some kind of way to make sure that all those get inputted into where it would be ticker. And then if you look at the bottom portion where it says I, that's your interval, that's 6, that means that you want data for every minute of the day, and P is equal to 1 day, so you're looking at 1 day's worth of data. And then these symbols over here, close, high, low, open, and the volume for the day. So at that point, we'll go ahead and hop into Google Finance and take a look at some of the data that they provide. So what it is that you'd get out of using that string to connect to Google's intraday market data service is it looks something like this, basic comma separated values. Your top 7 rows are just your header. Has some information about your interval. You'll see that it doesn't have a timestamp or any time. The way they measure it on this is it's actually using time from the epoch. Anyone that's really big into Unix, Linux, probably some understanding of that. So just time from the epoch going forward. again, this is data every minute. So going across, you have basically what it says at the top where it says columns equal. You have the date measured in epoch, then your close, high, low, open, and your volume. Just some quick background information on all that. So if you've ever seen a candlestick plot, is what they call them as far as financial markets go. So if we go back to what we're looking at regarding the Bloomberg terminal, so not the best on here, but you can kind of see on like this screen, you have some candlestick plots. And the way that those work is that instead of just having one point, since obviously the price can move multiple times within a minute, you'll have a whole range of prices. The top of the candle being the highest that the price went within the minute, the bottom of the candle being the lowest the price went. And then they have colors, green and red, to differentiate between whether it closed higher than it opened or it opened higher than it closed. So that's what you end up doing when you have all these disparate data points from Google Finance.
How long can you go back? Because you're saying minute by minute data.
Yeah. No, if you want intraday data, they let you go back about 3 months. That just gives you open, high, low, close for the day. If you want the minute by minute, it might be 2 or 3 days. It's not a very long time frame.
So you have to get that and store it yourself?
Yeah, you would. You would. I mean, alternatively, you could go out and just buy market data. But, I mean, like I said, that can be pretty expensive. Yeah. If you have a pretty good size trading account, you're dealing with, like, I don't know, a couple hundred thousand, then it's negligible, but... Yeah, if you're on the smaller end, it's data, it's too expensive. So what we can actually do at this point do you know if that is audio for the computer as well or no? No? No audio? Okay. Got it. I do have a quick video. We're just going to run through this right now because I am struggling a bit up here to try to figure out how the system's working. So just give me a second. I'll play this video, and during that time, I'll get all my bearings here and have something a little more productive going forward. And this video right here is just Nassim Taleb is just giving a quick brief on what the importance of having some skin on the game as far as the financial markets go.
Talk about how skin in the game plays out in the current financial crisis. I work on Wall Street. You have a lot of forms of asymmetries that are public. Corporation, right? You start, you own the corporation. Public now, and then you sell it to some manager. Now, a professional manager's aim is to look good so he can collect the bonus. He doesn't really care about the intrinsic health of the corporation. In banking, of course, bankers, we bail them out. I wrote on the Black Swan. I got so many letters that asked me to prove it because people didn't believe it, and also bankers, of course, didn't like my book. By the last quarter of 1982, banks lost more money money center banks that quarter than they made in the history of banking, because of money center banking. And of course, we bailed them out. So we started the moat under Reagan. And of course, later on, Greenspan made economic policy to accommodate.
You referred to Greenspan as the fragilista doctor.
Fragilista, exactly.
Yeah, okay.
But it's not just Greenspan that was a fragilista. It was a system that bailed out banks, nationalized Continental Illinois, and then suddenly, allowed this asymmetries to prevail.
Where is that coming from, though? Is that, and this is where you talk about it's. I mean, big government is necessary for that, but then the pressure is coming from the banking industry themselves.
Well, the whole combination, big government, big central government was a big, bailing out authority, coupled with a huge number of regulators who don't have a clue and who eventually are on indirectly on a take, because, in Africa, you see people have outright corruption, where I, give you diamonds or something. Whereas in Washington, you have this implicit, corruption. I call it the Tony Blair problem. The Tony Blair problem is you do a good job, and then you're going to go be able to work for $5 million a year at Goldman Sachs. So whatever you're going to do as a regulator is going to be there to either facilitate your job at Goldman Sachs or make regulations complex enough to make yourself necessary later on. And we have evidence of that.
You know, going back to that idea of a kind of fractal system, Adam Smith said that, while each person is pursuing their own, personal desires or their personal benefits, the whole system gets more robust. But you're saying actually that there are these actors in our system that are not the manager of the
exactly.
bank.
What makes
so how did that happen?
Okay.
And is that a necessary, or is it an inevitable outgrowth of larger and larger economic systems?
Exactly. No, it's not necessary for economic system. If you let things fail, mm-hmm. if you don't let things fail, you're going to have concentration of mistakes.
Right.
You see, that plus asymmetry doesn't work very well. Plus risk hiding, where you have regular. I mean, I was. Spent 20 years fighting something called value at risk that was mandated by regulators and allows people to hide risk in their tail. To me, when you have skin in the game, it solves so many problems. People are harmed first by their own mistakes.
So with the banking system, how do we make sure that the banks, and this is a common thing that, banks or mortgage underwriters were able to sell off whatever,
There you go.
They had nothing to lose by making bad deals. So
exactly.
how do you keep their skin in the game, especially when things are going to be traded on secondary and tertiary?
Yeah, I mean, you don't have to go as far as that. Just have at the level of the bank itself, right? So we don't bail out banks. Here we're bailing out individuals through these securitized mortgages. But just take a level of a bank. Bob Rubin made $120 million helping to stuff Citibank with risks.
Right.
And his boss made even more. And then they blew up, we're paying for it. And bankers even spat in our face by paying themselves 2010, higher level of bonuses than ever in history, all right? So how do we solve it? Very simple, I have rules.
Okay. So a couple things that he touched on in that video. Just many times, you've probably heard him say skin in the game. Multiple times he spoke about how there's a need for anyone who's actually running these large trading operations or any financial institutions to make sure that they feel any pain that they may previously have just not felt because they're dealing with other people's money, which is the ideal way to invest from a selfish perspective. But as far as stability of the markets, probably not the best. So as far as getting back into what it is that we're going to cover, the next thing we'll look at is a script that we have that we'll actually go through and read all the financial data that you would need to gather. So over here, basically what we have is just a script, again, with the beginning, you have all your imports. And the way that this one operates is it goes through and it will actually go to your different websites that you need in order to grab your financial data, and loop through your list of tickers one by one in order to capture every piece of data that you would need. So you see here you're establishing several lists, and then as you go down, there actually is a need to basically have Python mimic a actual web browser, so that's why we have a header file here that just tricks these websites into believing that you're going there and browsing them on your own, because some websites would just prefer not to have someone hitting their website maybe 600 times a minute, because it'll slow down traffic for everybody else. But selfishly, threw this code in here in order to confuse them and allow that to function. So as we continue to go down, I'm sorry, it's really hard to read from this vantage point. Okay, we'll skip that. And we are way ahead of schedule, so we'll just hop into some web scraping real quick, and we'll talk about building your database, and then take a quick break after that, run into the last part. And I have a feeling we're going to end a little bit before that, about an hour and 50 minutes that we have allotted. So you either have a lot of questions and answers, or just wrap up a little bit earlier. So as far as moving into the web scraping piece, so what it is you're doing when you're web scraping is other terms for it, screen scraping, web data extraction, web harvesting, whatever it is you want to call. Basically, this graphic at the bottom really shows what you have going on. You have a website with your HTML pages that gets back into your DOM that we spoke on earlier. And basically, what you know is you want to grab some information from there. So you write your script using tools like Python and Beautiful Soup, which allow you to get into your DOM and produce some structured data from there, whether you want to export it as a CSV tab delineated into a database. However it is you want to handle that, the choice is really up to you at that point. And there's lots of applications for web scraping. Financial data is one of them. You can scrape for social media websites with Beautiful Soup. If there's any data you want to scrape, I mean, you can really play around with it, have some fun. Go through Facebook pages and understand your friends' entire lives in short order. So some other examples of what it's used for in the real world. Search engine optimization, that's a big one. Company pages for social networks. You can also scrape in order to obtain any data as you might be looking for, as far as what else is going on the financial markets for any buyouts or anything like that. RSS feeds are also a huge help for things like that. So as far as the web scraping, this is another example of some of the code that we looked at earlier. Again, up here in the response section, this is where you're bringing in the web page that it is that you actually want to scrape. So it's the Google page, and then you're telling it how many header lines you want to skip, which are 7. So if you look, if you remember the Google data we're looking at for the intraday prices, there are about 7 header columns. That's why we're skipping 7 of them to get right into the meat of what we're looking for. And then there's also some matching to make sure that the data is indeed what it is we're looking for, just as a fail-safe to make sure we get exactly what it is that we need. And that's what I have for web scraping right now. I just wanted to take a 10-minute break. Sorry, the room's not quite set up how I was hoping, so still having some problems fighting through things. But yeah, quick 10-minute break, and then we'll continue chugging through the rest of it and kind of carry on from there. This portion is, I don't know how many people here have any database experience. Anybody? One? Okay. Handful of people. So it's extremely helpful in situations like this, because if you think about it, if you're getting minute-by-minute data, one stock alone, that's 3,600 times high open, low close. 3,600 times four data points for each individual stock. So if you're analyzing 15 or 20 a day, that grows exponentially quick. So if you jump into using a database as opposed to Excel or OpenOffice or CSVs, it's just a much more compact, easy to work with way of storing all the data it is that you have. The one we're going to be using is MySQL. It's open source software, one of the more popular ones that's used. If you need to get it, mysql.com, you can download it for free. A lot of interface with Python, very easy to work with. I'd highly recommend using that one. And I mean, I've stored a good amount of data in it, a couple gigs, and haven't had any issues. No crashes, persistent, fast, easy to work with, so highly recommended. And getting into how easy it is to work with, as far as if you want to create a database, you have to do this in the interpreter. You just simply, once you're in MySQL, you just simply put create database, and then you give your database a name, and that's how you go ahead and create that. And then within your database, it's basically set theory. So your database is a collection of tables. Your table is a collection of records. So your database is the biggest, and then your tables, and then your records going down. So before you can insert records into your table, you have to properly define your table's schema. So you want to make sure that you have all the column headers that you're going to need. So in this example, it's just using pets, so the names, the owner, the species, and then also the data type that we'd be using after that. So just real quick overview of the different data types that you would come across using MySQL. Characters, variable characters, text, date, pretty common stuff as far as databases go. So if we look at some of the code that's actually implementing this database, we scroll down here into this section here. This is really all it takes in order to get your data into your database. Prior to that, you have a loop that's looking into all the data that you scraped off of your Google Finance page, and then it's just going row by row and then inputting all that into your database from the web page. And then once it's done with that, it closes that web page out, moves over to the next one. As far as establishing your connection, scrolling up to the top, it's pretty basic stuff. You just need to initialize your database, create your cursor. That's all it takes. Just a host name, username, password, database name, and that's how you get into your database. And once you have that created, you can go ahead and put in any sort of data that it is you want. So then as far as getting everything into your MySQL database, that's some of what we just looked at. So again, down here, this is where your connection is. And you need to initialize your connection before you can get anything in or out of your database. So once you have that connection taken care of, just go ahead and throw all your data in. Commit it. Make sure to close out your database once you're done. And then the last piece, the actual data analytics, once it is that you have everything in your database. So there's really three pieces that you need for data analytics. You have your Pandas, NumPy, and also your matplotlib. Pandas is really the workhorse. It uses a lot of NumPy, which NumPy is basically all arrays, great for mathematics. It's basically Python's mathematic library tie-in. Matplotlib, that's where you can generate all your graphs from, and again, Pandas. Makes it very easy to do things, statistical ranges, basically any type of stats operations that you're interested in. Pandas is great for that. Just a little background on Pandas, open source, BSD, not Pandas, created by this guy, Wes McKinney. Real sharp dude. I think he launched it when he was like 26 or 27. As far as working with Pandas, just like anything else in Python, you want to make sure to import at the beginning. Typically, you want to import the three Pandas Numpy and also Matplotlib, since they all rely on each other so heavily. And when you're working with pandas, the real name of the game is data frames. And that's very similar to what you work with if you are used to using Excel, except it's all stored within your Python script. So that can be advantageous as far as manipulating data quickly and effectively. So your data frame looks exactly like this. You have your column headers going across the top. You have your index across the side, and then your actual values here. And this is just a quick example using NumPy in order to create your data frame. It's just using a simple random number generator. And then you have your dates as your index going down the side. And then your list of columns. When you're actually doing this with stock data, obviously you'd want to have your open, high, low, close, and your volume going across the side. Just showing how easy it is to work with it. Once you have your data frame created, just call the method describe, and it can give you some pretty good summary information, some summary statistics. So then jumping into the Python code that we're using as far as pandas goes. One thing that pandas is really good for is creating histograms, which as far as stock prices go, it's fairly helpful. So we'll just run this really quick and look at the histogram it spits out. So what is this saying here? What we're looking at in this piece of code is you're looking at all the stocks that on the previous day had somewhere between a 70% move and a 40% move. And we're looking at the next day's worth of data to try to guess what might happen during the next day's stock trading. And the exact time we're looking at right now is around 10:33, so about an hour after the market opens, where are these stocks that move between 70 and 40%? And I mean, if you were to guess, I would probably say that if it went up 70% the day before, it should probably go up the following day. But I mean, looking at this histogram, if you can kind of imagine a little normal curve shape, a lot of them didn't really move at all. There's a good majority that tanked the next day. I mean, one was down about 40-something percent within the first hour of trading, so. Yeah, imagine if that was your stock, little get your heart going. You won't need coffee that day. Maybe some Xanax. Then you only had a few that actually moved up. So really kind of slugging through all the actual going through, scraping your tickers from your sites daily and then creating your database. What you can do with that is really just go back in time and see what happened with stocks. And from there, get a fairly good idea of what might happen the following day. So. For example, here, if we want to move some of these around, we want to look at stocks that move somewhere between, let's say, 50 up to a 90% gain the previous day, and we want to see what it looked like at, say, 11:45. And as it's going through this, it shows you the date that it occurred. So as you can see, some of this is going back to 2014. The prior days move over here 80, 50, and the current days move negative 18, negative 3.
What's called the global value here?
I had some different ways of keeping time in the database before, and I didn't clear out some of that. So I wasn't using a 24-hour clock initially, which created some issues once you moved past noon, obviously. But then switched over to a 24-hour clock, and it works a lot better. So where you see the value errors, that's just some residual data from when I was using a 12 as opposed to 24. So as you can see here, looks like you might be pretty good off shorting any stock that has a huge move the day before. I mean, you'd get burned on one that went up your 18%, but I mean, just pure probability, you're more than likely going to make some money, and again, you have some pretty heavy losers skewed to the left. I mean, likewise, we can also look at negative movements. So if you want to look at everything that moves between, let's say, negative 20 to negative 50. Any guesses on what happens for this? You're assuming they go up the next day?
Right,
time will tell.
Usually sell off, so
It is a full day in between, though, so you have the whole night for people to cool off and some price discovery in the morning.
It's a truly random market, which is more often than
not. I'll have to watch a BC's tutorial as far as asynchronous processing could cut down the amount of time this takes by a lot. This is in my database, but it's doing a few operations to each of them prior to adding it to the histogram. So basically once you have the code for it, it has a lot to do with your system. My laptop's a little older too, so it's just gonna run a little bit slower. As you start to really build your data warehouse of stock movements, you can really, as you can see, add some time to how long it takes to draw these histograms. Let me kill this, make this range a little bit more extreme so that we don't have quite so many data elements we're gonna be looking at. While we're waiting for that to finish cooking, just a little article. I don't know if anyone remembers back in 2010. I can't remember what the firm was called, like Knight Capital Group or something like that. But anyways, there's something that they called the flash crash where from 2:45 basically onward for about 36 minutes, everything was just in free fall. So is that 100% because of algorithmic trading? I'd say most likely, because the way a lot of these systems are set up is a little bit more advanced than what I have. You're actually doing your data analysis in real time, but same general idea. You're going to want to be scraping your data from some source. And then you'll notice some strange aberrations in the market now that as a stock price starts to move somewhat, it can really take off in a matter of moments and then zip all the way back down. High-frequency trading, which is an outgrowth of algorithmic trading, which is basically just using computer software to make your decisions as opposed to humans. Huge business right now. If you want to get into quant development, get a PhD in computer science or physics and try to head over to Manhattan and get one of these shops and you can pretty much retire by your 30th birthday. And so the only issue with it is you have some problems where once it just hits the logic that your software decides that it might be time to buy or sell, so you might get stuck in a loop where that's just happening ad nauseum, which is basically what happened here, and it's just a giant sell-off that what they actually ended up doing the next day was just saying that some trades didn't count. So let's say you caught wind of this and you shorted something, you made like, I don't know, $50,000. The next day they're just like, well, that trade's no good just because the market moved too much, which I think is ridiculous, but that's how it goes sometimes. Everybody running for the hills, absolutely. That can happen. Start to see your pension evaporate. Can be a bit of an issue. So this is what we're looking at where things fell. The range that we put on this one was anywhere between 40 to negative 70% the day before. So if you look at the graph here, most things moved up. You had one loser that fell about 5%. Everything else was in the positive territory, a couple heavily positive. The one thing you will notice is the sample size is fairly small. It's because we're looking at such an extreme move of down 40 to down 70% within the span of one day. A little counterintuitive. It seems more buy the losers, sell the winners. But as you create your own data profile, you will be able to analyze that and come to your own conclusions.
What could be like the average percentage return using a system like this? Monthly or daily?
It depends what you're buying into. Here, let me pull something up that will be a little bit more telling. So since looking at those histograms, it takes a little bit of time, not the way to analyze all your stock movements. What I did also do is create some scripts that spits out, give 1 second to load, this spreadsheet. And what you have here is your average and your standard deviation of movements based on the prior day's movements and also your time frames going across the top. So over here is if you had a drop of 100 to 75%, what that looked like the following day between 9:30 and 9:31. So basically going on the premonition that if something were to fall or gain a substantial amount the day before, the following day you will most likely see some movement. So as far as your average that you can expect to see, it really depends how far into the outliers you want to move. So if you start getting into this territory of this above 30 the day before, I mean, you can see you can start getting some pretty wild moves. The number on the left, that's your average. The number on your right is your standard deviation. So that's the other thing. Some of these are pretty spread out, standard deviation of 23%. So you have things pretty far out on either side. But as far as general trends, you can kind of see some stuff from some of the buckets. Like if you look down here in the 75 to up to 500%, vast majority seem to lose at least within the first few minutes of opening. This goes, it's, you know, 9:30 to 9:37. So basically if you were to buy in at 9:30, sell at 9:47, you would have lost on average 4% with a 9% standard deviation. If it was a stock that gained between 75 to somewhere up to 500%, which the greatest gain I've ever seen has been around 300% in a day. 500 is pretty far out there. But yeah, basically what I encountered from doing this little experiment, and some of the outliers, you can see some trends as far as movements the following day. But I mean, anything in the middle, you just kind of get a lot of noise. Very low average, pretty wide standard deviation. So it's basically just, yeah. Pretty random. But then as you get into other things such as news.
Can you correlate this to news coverage and media coverage on different sites? And could you use that as a variable to narrow down some of the standard deviations? Where, you know, if it made this much gain and was covered by this site,
yeah, that's absolutely a possibility. You can really take this to the next level as far as looking into what other things you can incorporate. I mean, right now it's only looking at prior days' movements and then also time of day during the next day. But as far as you can break it up into different industries, certain industries have different movements. For example, your biotech stocks are much more likely to have huge spikes on those than you are in like your blue chips. Whereas, say, like if Google's down 10% one day, it's probably going to continue to go down the next day just because it's such a larger company as opposed to some of the smaller stocks. But yeah, like you said, as far as incorporating news, you'd have to get much more granular on that. You really have to know what you're looking for as far as what stories are what. And just a little anecdote as far as news goes. There was one trade that I got into. It's with this Nevada resources company. And it was up about 20% because there were some buyout rumors. And typically when a stock is gonna get bought out, you see that it either, it basically just spikes way up 1 second to the next and just trails off there. Because the current value that the stock is trading at is whatever the company is gonna acquire it for. So if a company says you're trading at 25, I'll pay 38 for you. You'll typically see it start trading around 37, 50 because there's still some risk that the deal might not close. But yeah, as far as this one goes, the news story came out that a Chinese company was gonna be acquiring them. Turns out the whole thing was just completely bogus. Some guys caught wind that you can spread some fake news about the company being bought out. I'm sure they made some pretty nice gains on it, and then the thing just dropped to oblivion right afterwards.
Did you get in trouble for that, like posting fake news?
Absolutely. So the SEC has, their standard is to defraud the markets. It's something along those lines. You have to look it up to know exactly what it is. But there's a lot of things that you could consider fraud on the markets. Obviously, spreading a fake news story, that's most definitely fraud. I cannot advocate that. But yeah, there's definitely rules to how you can play. And spreading fake news stories is not one of the acceptable options. Implications of it scaling and being widely adopted. So,
what if 25% of investors started using bots to make all their decisions instead of just major companies and financial institutions? What effect might that have on the market, if you care to speculate?
Yeah, I mean, my speculation would be it would probably look pretty similar to what's going on now. I'm sure they're the same type of gamesmanship going on currently. Because, I mean, all these firms are out trying to make money, and the only way you make money is if someone else loses money. So I'm sure there's a lot of games that go on, probably why you see such wild spikes in the market, where a stock will be up 15% 1 minute, the next minute it'll be down another 10. I'm sure it's a lot of outgrowth. If you look at the overall volume, how many shares are traded per day from pre-algorithmic trading to post-algorithmic trading, I mean, that went way, way up because...
Like 60,
70, 80% of its computers. Absolutely. I mean, it all started off in like the pits in New York where people were literally screaming out how much they wanted to buy or sell shares for. And originally you can only use whole numbers, so $1, $2, $3 a share, whatever you wanted to spend. And then they broke away from that and they actually got into fractions. So every now and then you'll see someone talking about they're paid 14 and 17, 30 seconds. That's just because they didn't have decimalization in the pits. But not everything's computerized decimalization. You can buy shares actually at fractions of a penny. So sometimes you'll see someone pay like 14.0003, which doesn't matter for you or me, but I mean, if you're Goldman Sachs and you got a couple $1 billion trading book, then that's a little bit of a different story.
So you did a little bit of analysis there when you just were doing the average of the step deviations. Have you done any other analysis, like, you know, back testing of a policy or, you know, pairs analysis?
As far as the analysis, this is really what I was looking for, just to have enough data in order to go in here, and this is basically what I was using as my back testing, because this is going over each bucket has multiple stocks that are being analyzed, which is why I can have both a average and standard deviation. And basically I was just looking for if there's any movements that have a surefire probability to gain or lose the next day. Just looking for some type of consistency as far as what happens in the prior day to what happens in the next day. And I mean, from the numbers that I was able to come up with here after doing this for about 6 to 9 months, it just really didn't show any consistency to the point where I felt that it was a clear signal on what to trade on.
Now, were you doing just, you know, the market in general, or were you doing your group of stocks?
Market in general. I have not done that analysis, so. And one other thing that we'll look at here, this kind of also goes back to your question as far as backtesting goes. What this is producing is it's going to look at a graph of what happens over the course of the next day for any stock that gained above 6% the prior day. So you'll be able to see the minute by minute changes of how the values moved. So I'll just take a minute for all that data to accumulate. Shouldn't be too much longer.
How many stocks per day typically move in this kind of range?
60? Not a ton. I'd say between 0 to 3, unless you're counting penny stocks. One thing that I do on this is I do filter anything out that's trading at less than $3 a share, and anything that has less than about 1 million shares that trade hands in that day. Because, I mean, if you look at certain stocks, like we said, with the decimalization, there's some penny stocks that can be valued at literally a fraction of a cent. So should it be valued at 1 cent as opposed to a fraction of a cent, you'll see a 300% gain. But, I mean, you don't want to invest in something that's trading at a fraction of a cent, unless you really know what you're doing. So, yeah, basically what I was trying to communicate is that I just saw a lot of noise. So these are stocks that moved 60% the prior day. You can see there's pretty much a huge distribution between which ones dipped, which ones moved up the next day, not enough to create a tradable signal. So as far as your point is trying to pair it up with maybe some market data, look at some different industries, maybe that'll help to clear up some of the noise. I haven't gotten to that point myself yet, but I mean, that'd be a great way to continue going with this and see what else can be discovered. As far as material, that's most of what I had. Does anyone have any questions or anything that they want to look at, have explained more? Yes.
Have you used Quandl for data?
I'm sorry, what?
Quandl?
I have not used Quandl.
I've used it for futures, and I look at dev stocks too.
Yeah? Quandl, okay.
Yeah, I think it's an aggregator of data suppliers.
Yeah. Okay, great. I'll have to look into that. Any other questions, comments, market predictions? The movie Pi. Sorry, I haven't seen that one either. How did it turn out? Based on the graph, we just looked like that seems totally possible. All right, and just some of the sources, if you want to get into the packages that were used in this or just any other basic information on how to put some license together. W3 School is a great place. NumPy, Pandas, Tutorials Point, MySQL. All great resources. And also just want to give a thank you to all friends and family who have supported me through this, the organizers who put this conference on, all of you for bearing with me for the last hour and some minutes, and then also sponsors and all the attendees. Well, thank you very much for your time. Appreciate it.